So hi, I would like to welcome you very warmly and I'm pleased that you are watching this video. Today I want to talk about artificial neural networks and I would like to give you a very basic and elementary introduction into these topics. In this video we don't care about any application or programming or implementation, but above all of the idea and the mathematics behind the topics. A quick word about myself. My name is Stefan Noertemann. I'm a mathematician and an actuary and employee at MSG Life. And I'm also head of the section Actuarial Data Science of the German Society of Actuaries. So let's start with the presentation. I want to talk about artificial neural networks and I want to answer some questions, maybe, for example, what are neural networks, who invented them, what are the basic components, how do they work and why do they work, why we can use neural networks for machine learning. And today we will turn to the first three questions. But before we start, let's have a small, short look into history. 100 years ago, a man, a Spanish doctor called Ramon y Cajal, was the first who systematically examined brains. And he was the first, he has an idea how our nerve cells communicate with each other. And so he has the idea of our brain, and later on he was awarded with the Nobel Prize in Medicine for this. A few years later, two men, Warren McCulloch and Walter Pitts, as the first idea to use the artificial neural networks for calculation of logical and arithmetic functions. And 15 years later, Frank Rosenblatt was the first who built a neural computer, the so-called Mark I perceptron. And it was the first neural computer which uses the information about the communication of the nerve cells in the brains. And then we get the first boom of artificial neural networks. So, what are the basic components of an artificial neural network? The idea is make it like the human brain. And so we have several units which are arranged in several layers and the units are connected with each other between the layers. And every unit has several inputs and generate one output. And the output of a neuron of a unit can maybe an input for another unit of the next layer. And each connection between units still carries a so-called weight. And this weight is very important for training a neural network. So we have some units called neurons or units. They are arranged in several layers. The layers in between are the so-called hidden layers. And we have connections between the units and we have a weight at every connection. So, and analogous to our brain, a unit exceeds only an output if a specified threshold is exceeded. So we have a situation of non-linearity here. And to simulate this in our artificial neural network, we use a so-called activation function. So if we calculate within a unit an output, we apply an activation function to get the real output. And here I have several activation functions used in practice. For example, the rectified linear unit, ReLU, or the sigmoid function, or the hyperbolic tangent, or logistic, or there are several things, but the first three activation units are used in practice. So here I have a very, very small and simple artificial neural network, for example. Please note, in practice, we have maybe 100,000 units and maybe a dozen or 100 or 200 layers. And then we speak about deep learning. If we have so much layers, 200 layers, for example, then we talk about deep learning. Here we have a very, very simple neural networks, for example, for show you how to compute an input, an output from an input in this. Here we have 9 units and 3 layers, only one hidden layer here in blue. So we have here 4 input units, A, B, C, and D, 3 hidden units, E, F, G, and 2 output units. Please note, it's a very simple example, and in practice you have maybe 10,000 of input units and maybe 200 hidden layers and maybe a dozen or 100 output units. So first I have to choose an activation function. Here I have chosen the ReLU function with 0.5. as, for example, here for this very simple artificial neural network. At next, I have to choose weights. And this I will do at first randomly. I've randomly choose the weights between the connections between the units. Here we see the rows and the weights. So, the next step is I take the first data record of my data set. So I want to do machine learning. So I have training data sets with several data records. In practice, I have maybe 100,000 or a million of data records. I take the first one, and here I have 4 inputs for the input units: 0.5, 0.2, 1.0, and minus 0.5, here in this example, for the first data record of my training data set. So this is the setting, and now I want to calculate the output of this simple neural network with the input of the first data record of my training data set. And I can do it, and I will get 0.9 and 1.2 at the output units. But stop, what have I done in detail? That was too fast. Let's have a deeper look into a special unit. For example, the unit E. What have I calculated within the unit E? There I have the four input neurons, A, B, C, and D, and I have the 4 weights for the connections between the input units and the unit E. And then I have calculated the convex combination between the inputs and the weights. So I have chosen the product of every input with the weight, then I sum them up, and then I have applied the activation function, ReLU 0.5, and then I get 0.6 as an output of the unit E. And I have then done this for every single unit here in this very simple example. And then I get at the output units, the output 0.9 and 1.2. So let me give a small excursus. In practice, I don't use the colored circles here. Colored circles are only for illustration how an artificial neural network works. In practice, I use vectors and matrices. Here, for example, I have calculated the output of the unit E, as example before, with using vectors, input vectors, matrices for the weights, and then I have multiply them and I get the output. In practice, this is the way to calculate the output of an artificial neural network. And that's very nice because in the programming languages which are used for machine learning, R or Python, these languages are able to compute multiplication and calculation with vectors and matrices. And so it's very simple to program a neural network, an artificial neural network, with R or Python. And that we do in practice. So now we have seen how to compute the input and get an output for a single data record. But what we do now with this? Please remember, we want to do machine learning. We have several training data records and we have chosen the first one. And here I want to do supervised machine learning. So I have not only the input values in my data record, I have also the expected output values for my training data set. So now I know what I have expected for this input. And for this input, for the first data record of my data training data set, I have expected an output of the unit H of 1.5 and for the unit E of 2.0. So I have a deviation between the calculation and the expected values. But that's not surprising because I have chosen the weights randomly. So I can't expect here that the calculated output is nearby the expected output. So what have I done now? Now I choose a so-called error function or cost function. In this example, I take the deviations, square them and sum them up. And if I sum them up, I will get an error of 1.0. I don't know if it's much or not, but it's by applying the error function, I will get an error of 1.2. And the aim is now to increase this error. So, and this will be the topic of my next lecture. At this stage of my presentation, we know how to process an input and generate an output for a simple artificial neural networks. And please note, we have here a very simple, but in practice you have a big deep learning with maybe 100,000 units, but it's the same calculation. So it's the same if you have a small artificial neural network or a big. So we know how to process an input and get an output. We know the expected output, and now we can apply the so-called backpropagation for increasing the error. And this will be the topic of my next lecture, also here at ActiveView. Thank you very much for your attention, and in my next lecture I will show you how to do backpropagation for increasing the error of our artificial neural network. Thanks a lot and bye bye.